you know, and it's fair to the person too, because none of us like to be placed into a situation where we don't feel qualified to do it. You know, like, yeah. I'm going to give it my level best, but you know, we hate stinking it up.
Okay, welcome to Challenging Leadership. My name is Stephen, and on this podcast, we like to do just that, challenge what we think we know about leadership. And as always, I have my good friend from across the pond, Jared. Welcome, Jared.
Hey, how are you doing today?
I'm very, very well. So, Jared, awesome. We're going to talk today about, I've sort of framed it as a kind of quote, you know, so you're good at your job. Let's give you a different one. So what are we talking about today?
Oh, goodness. We're talking about when people get promoted into leadership positions and they're probably not qualified yet.
Yeah. Yeah. And I reckon that probably goes for pretty much every leader or manager who is either one now or just been made one. Probably their first leadership role was just that, you know, so they were good at their job. I work in manufacturing, so it could well be that they were good on the line, they were good at doing the job, very hard working, great attitudes, intelligent, and so somebody looked at them and went, oh, they'd be good at being a leader, and then they get made into a team leader or something like that, and all of a sudden they're now asked to do something completely different from the thing that made them good.
Exactly. Yeah, it's fascinating to me because it happens every time. We naturally see the all-star workers, the ones that are just standing above everybody else, and go, hey, let's make them a leader because they're just so good at what they do.
Yeah, yeah. So what could I suppose the question is then what are they lacking? What are the skills then that they are going to need? So that question. The next one would be, what should businesses do about it? And I suppose if we're an operational manager in charge of that situation, what can we do about it? So I guess those are the questions that we could explore today.
Sure.
What is it that people are lacking then? Why is it a problem?
Well, you said it in your question. You said people, and I think that the biggest or one of the biggest attributes a true leader can have is they have to be a people person. And so I think a lot of people just miss out on that. They see the guy that's not performing very well, but I'm not saying he's a people pleaser, but he gets along with people. He knows how to communicate his situation. He can explain to you in a non-emotional way, hey, this is what I'm dealing with. We need to be able to fix this problem, so on and so forth. So, but I don't think people look at that. They go, I always hear, they're such a high performer. Right. And I'm like, and nobody usually says, wow, they really know how to get along with people. They know how to pull people together. Do you see them? They're working with Tim and Bob and they hate each other. And now all three of them are working together on a project and they're doing just fine. And I'm like, oh, there's some cohesiveness there because he is a people person. So
yeah,
I think that could be one of the issues there is they're not looking under the microscope at the right things.
That's interesting. Yeah. So the people are getting chosen for leadership roles on the basis of perhaps technical skills or simply hard working, but that doesn't necessarily mean they'll make a good leader.
And I think it's the problem with that is that you know, we're both in the training business, right? And you probably agree that it's much easier to train somebody on a technical aspect of a job rather than those people skills, those human skills, or some people say soft skills. But you know, that's tough to teach people that. So you just say there's some people that are just naturally they're good at people, and we don't focus on that a lot of times. We're just more like, wow, look how many widgets they built, or and automatically we pick them, and you've got the unassuming guy in the corner or the woman in the corner that's they're doing their job and they're getting missed out.
Yeah, and you know, if the guy in the corner who's producing all those widgets, you're taking that person off the widget making. Who is the best widget maker? And you're giving them a completely different job that they're not necessarily suited to. And as you say, there might be this other person in the other corner who actually has all the skills or potential anyway to do it. So in my training, I tend to try to separate a little bit out the idea of leadership and management. So for me, management is all about organizing things, organizing your resources, managing your processes, essentially. So you're putting processes in place, you're using those processes, you're doing all the measurements, and you're taking action when you need to, all that sort of stuff, planning, organizing, that sort of thing. Leadership is the bit that is the people stuff, particularly. So it's influencing people, getting people to change what they're doing, or giving instruction clearly, communicating, those sorts of things, motivating, inspiring. That's the leadership side. So yeah, for me, it's about having a bit of a balance between those two and having at least some of those qualities that sit in both camps. I don't know whether you see it the same way.
I do. I mean, at the end of the day, based on what they're going to be leading or managing, they do have to have some knowledge or understanding of what's going on. Because I've seen that too. Maybe we'll go opposite take.
Yeah.
You bring in somebody who's strictly, hey, I'm an educated MBA manager. And they also maybe be a people person, but they have no knowledge of these widgets and the process. And so they totally muck it up that way, you know? So again, I agree there has to be a balance. But the danger, I think, of, again, focusing on the high performers is that it becomes imbalanced very quickly, because that hard worker, that doesn't leave them. So if they're overseeing a production area, they're wanting to jump in and help out with the production. So they have a hard time, one, delegating. They don't know how to delegate. Two, their face is down in the work, and they're not looking at the big picture of where people are at, where are your problems, where are your high performers. So they're not seeing any of that, because again, they're just focused on what they focused on their career wise, and that's making widgets.
So what is the answer to this then? Because there is something for learning on the job. There's something about, you know, of course, we all learn a lot through doing. So what's the answer to this problem?
When we were throwing this topic out there, one of the things that I was thinking about a few days ago was, it's like anything, almost call it reverse troubleshooting. You know, when you're trying to repair, say, a circuit, or you're trying to fix something with your car, you do things incrementally. And so what they do sometimes is they take somebody, I hope I'm not wearing out the widget maker, but you know, we can call it something else, but they do that. And then all of a sudden we push them all the way up the chain, and now they're some supervisor or manager. And there are some, maybe perhaps they're not established by the HR company, that there's levels, but you could create your own levels of like, hey, I'm going to give them a little more responsibility incrementally to see how they handle it. And then when you do that, then you're able to coach them and guide them and see, oh, they like this. Okay, let's give them a little more and a little more. And then you can build them to the point of like, all right, let's do this. You know, that's one way. But does that ever happen? Usually not. It's, again, you take the high performer and you just drop them right there in a role that's, oh my goodness, they don't know how to do any of this. And then it creates frustrations all around.
Yeah, I that's right. And it's actually a really common sense way of doing it. You know, I mean, development and succession, we used to call it DAS. And yeah, you can have a bit of a pipeline of talent. You know, we have labor shortages in lots of industries at the moment in the UK. I think you have the same in the US. So that's not always easy, but the idea is that you're spotting people who could be next year's, in a couple of years, the next people to move up to the next level, if you like. And you're saying, okay, this person has potential. I like the way they interact with each other, and you know, they know what they're doing. So let's, as you say, let's gently start introducing them to some of the tasks that are the sorts of tasks that they would do. It doesn't have to be a formal arrangement even. It can just be, okay, you know, I want you to have a look at this data and with me, and we'll talk about it. And, or I want, you know, when I'm away, I'd like you to deputize for me or deputize for somebody else who's away just for an hour or two or something like that, you know? So it's gradual process.
Yeah, gradual is key. And the other part about that is you naturally create, I guess you could say, inertia for the whole team or the department liking the decision. And you may have seen this, but it's like if somebody just gets promoted out of the blue, it's like, oh, look at them, little brown noser, he's high performing. And all of a sudden, look at him, now he's a manager. And it's like, but if you incrementally give somebody and then you've heard it, I've heard it. People said, wow, you know what? They really picked a good person there. I'm not surprised at all by that. And I think one of the things that you can tell, and not always, because of course, there's always disgruntled people, but if people go, wow, they made a solid choice there, that lets you know that the process worked very well. And that's why that incremental addition of little leadership bits till they get to that point, I think it helps out as far as the morale of the department or the company, because they're seeing, wow, this really made sense. It's organic. And organic leadership is going to just go across as authentic and real. You know, and it's fair to the person too, because none of us like to be placed into a situation where we don't feel qualified to do it. You know, like, I'm going to give it my level best, but you know, we hate stinking it up.
You know, I work with all sorts of, I tend to work with operational managers. I think you probably do too. And often they are the first line leaders. So I'll be meeting often quite young people who sometimes feel a bit inadequate or struggle a little bit because they're leading people who've been there 20 years or something, and they notice it, you know, they feel it, they feel the this credibility gap that might be there because of their age. Obviously, I try to help them with that in the programs that I run, but yeah, as you say, if they're gradually doing that through this incremental process, then everybody gets used to it. They get used to it, and they're more confident. People are used to the fact that they're given responsibility, and yeah, everything works a lot better that way. Yeah, so that's one way of doing it, is this having the presence of mind as a manager to look at the people in your team and identify people that want to and have the capability of maybe in time having leadership roles, and start to just give them little bits of responsibility. And of course, that part of that is to feed back then as well. So you've got a coaching opportunity then as a manager to look at, right, how did that go? You know, so it's not like you just throw them in and then they sink or swim. You're kind of, how did that go? How did that meeting go that you were leading that time? Tell me about what happened there, and so you're kind of coaching them as they go as well.
Yeah, and that's an excellent point about coaching, because probably most of the times people get put into a leadership position and it's like, there you go, pat them on the back.
That's right.
and good luck with that, and then they don't address the leader again until they actually see a problem. But what does it take for that problem to get known by the higher ups? Well, there's obviously been something going on for a while. You start seeing performance reviews, or you see lack in disciplinary issues, whatever it is. So you've allowed a problem to grow and fester for quite some time. Instead of a really, if you're putting someone in a leadership position, they should have a mentor or a coach, as you put it, somebody who can along the way check in with them.
Yeah.
And it's somebody you can trust, and also somebody that's going to give you good leadership advice, not sway you the wrong way. And then they're going to be able to grow into that role. Cause I don't think you can pick the perfect leader each time. We're all going to have to learn, and we continue to learn, but they don't get that coaching. Usually someone gets appointed into that and it's like, hey, you're on your own.
Yeah, and, absolutely.
And that's tough.
Yeah. So this process of gradual exposure to leadership duties, I suppose, gives you the opportunity as a manager to coach that person and help them as they get exposure to these different situations, and that increases their confidence and increases their ability as well. So when they're actually given that role, then it's a lot easier. What about so obviously, without wanting to self-promote, but what is the role of training in this whole process? So, you know, when at what point do these people need some formal training, and what sort of formal training do you think is useful?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, I can speak to something that happened with me one time when I stepped into a leadership role as a manager. It took, I think it was 7 months in, they said, "Hey, we're having this class on supervisors." That's, I'm like, bad. Thanks.
7 months is not bad.
No, not bad at all. But yeah. It is great. But I was just thinking, usually what they do is companies have the mindset, let's get a collective. Okay, we've captured enough people in the dragnet. Mm-hmm. So then now we can have a training class. Mm-hmm. And, sounds great, but I think that before you do that, there needs to be some individualized training. There's plenty of things out there. I mean, I know somebody I'm talking to right now that has things available for that type of content to learn, but it's like that should start immediately. There should be some training that person takes, and there's no excuse with the technology we have. You don't have to go to a seminar. You don't have to go physically to a class. There's things online. Start with something. Mm. Give them that, you know, in that way you've got them going at least in the right direction generally. And then, yeah, sure. You have these big seminars like Supervisors 101 or whatever, go to that, but have something before then, because now you're just, it can be a disaster.
Right. Okay. I totally agree with that. Let's get it out of the way then. Let's get all our, our self-promotion out of the way. Okay. So, first of all, there's books, isn't there?
Yes, Jared? There is. There is books. In fact, you know, there, I hate to put it up here in the screen. I've got it right here. Authentic Leadership, exactly. What Really Works.
And that actually, I think, is a really good starting place for a new manager. So that sort of book is really accessible. It's quick to read. It's the sort of thing you can just, oh, I've got this coming up, let me have a quick look at that. So, and it's a very accessible way of just starting this process. So that's a good way. You're right. I have some online training courses on a platform called Udemy, which people have probably heard of. Mine is one of the best sellers on Udemy. It's called Leadership Masterclass, I think. He's forgotten what the name is. But my name is on there, along with the person who helped me make that program called Mark Timberlake. So check out the Masterclass, Leadership and Management Masterclass, I think it's called. And yeah, I mean, you can buy these things for about $20. You know, they're so cheap. And often businesses will have a subscription to them as well. So you can access them through the company, intranet or whatever. Okay, that out of the way. Then we have another level, I would say. So some of what I do is going into a business. I suppose you do it in-house. I do it as an external contractor where, yes, you've got a number of people who need some sort of team leadership training or middle manager training. And so I deliver a three-day course on that. So they're generally a month apart. So you do something on behavior the first day, you do something on systems or processes the next day, you do something else the next day, giving people time to talk to their manager about the program and get some feedback and so on. So that's another level. And then, yes, you've got the more formal programs with qualifications behind them. In the UK, we have the ILM, Institute of Leadership Management, CIPD. There's various different bodies, Chartered Institute. I'm sure you've got the same sorts of things.
Very similar, yes.
In the US. And these offer qualifications, and they also have their place, I think. But they're very different. So all these things actually fulfill a different niche, I think, in a leader's journey.
Yes, they certainly do. The key there is there's all this out there, and I go, why aren't people taking advantage of it?
Yeah.
And what I think it is that we have, you know, I think about where I work, we have a preventive maintenance with a lot of our equipment because it's very expensive equipment. And so there are scheduled times. The machine doesn't say, hey, I'm hurting right now, or my bearings are going out. It's just something maintenance routinely checks, grease the bearings or check on the belts or whatever. And we only address leadership issues when we see a problem. And the opposite mentality is where you're going to find benefit. And that is, hey, I want you to take a course. And I love Udemy, and my team, I tell them, I was like, every 90 days, I want you to take a little 5 or 10 minute course on something. Mm-hmm. And I let them choose. I'm like, I don't care what it is. If it's learning how to do a vegetable garden or something, but do something because I want you to continually learn. Mm-hmm. But if we adopt that mindset of having a hunger and a thirst for knowledge, but also in this case, specific knowledge, growth, when it comes to leadership, like you said, everything's out there. It's easily accessible. It's not like you've got to go get an MBA or anything. You know, you can just take your time and do that, but don't wait till you have a problem. Do it to just keep yourself fresh.
That's interesting. So that sounds a lot like PPM, we call it, planned preventative maintenance of machinery. So let's do that for leaders. So leadership planned preventative maintenance. Absolutely. It's a really good point. We shouldn't. Good businesses don't wait until the machine breaks. Mm-hmm. They plan in downtime for the machine so that it can be checked and parts replaced and so on. And that means that it's more efficient and it continues to operate for longer. Why is the same not done for leaders? Managers,
we don't have time. Nobody has 10 or 15 minutes to do that, but we have 30 minutes to sit around the water cooler and talk about what we did this weekend or the football match.
Yes.
And I'm just being honest. I'm like, I hate when I hear people say they don't have time, and I'm like, we all have time, we've just chosen to use our time in different areas. And they look at this leadership thing as this huge mountain, and I'm like, no, it's just, I was like, you know, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. So do the same thing with enhancing your leadership.
Yeah. Yeah, I totally agree. And I like the fact that we've got all these different modes and ways of learning these days. I mean, you know, you go back 20 years and you simply didn't have all of that. So you really do now. So that, and there's new things happening all the time. I got contacted recently by a company that are doing micro training sessions. So we're talking about a few minutes each time. So I'm looking into doing some of that stuff. I suppose it's like the TikTok stuff so on. And there are some definite things you can learn from some of those. So yeah, there's lots of stuff out there. I suppose I would, here is my cautious streak coming out.
Let's have it. We got to have a little bit of pushback. Let's hear it.
Okay, so my only concern is that there's also a lot of crap around.
Yes.
So yes, there's a lot of stuff, but there's also a lot of not very good stuff. And the problem is it because of the wonderful opportunities everyone has now to publish and put their opinions across, it's kind of flattened out. So it's hard to know what's good advice and what is not, what is evidence-based and what's just, you know, pulled out of somebody's backside, you know. So I
100%.
How do we go about knowing that?
Oof. That's tough, because I was actually thinking about that. I'm like, you know, you can find something to affirm your leadership style. You could be a crap leader, and there's somebody out there who's did a video that says you're doing a great job.
Yeah,
keep on doing more of that. Yeah. What I found fascinating is I wrote an article on LinkedIn, and it's my most popular article, and it was entitled "You're a Terrible Leader."
Yeah, that was good.
Nobody wanted to hear that. But at the end of the day, that wasn't really the point of it. But I think that's the thing that we have to recognize in ourselves is what are our blind spots. So if you're going to find the right training, you got to have a peer that can review with you, what am I struggling with? What do you think I could do better? You know, it's so hard to do that because we don't really like to be told we're doing bad at something, especially when it comes to leadership, because leadership is not a math problem. You know, if you told me 2 + 2 = 5, I could say, let's look at this. You're wrong. Here's why. It's black and white. But when you're talking about somebody's not a good leader, okay, well, that's very abstract. How do I really paint that? This is really a problem. So that's tough. And again, like you said, we just have so much out there, and some of it is crap or rubbish. and it's rubbish. Bad.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I forget where I read it now. So if next time we speak, I'll credit the writer. But I was reading somewhere about leadership, and at the beginning of it, it says, you know, leadership is a bit like driving a car and making love. You know, everybody thinks they're great at it.
Yeah. Yep, that's so a great quote.
It's very difficult to be presented with the fact that actually this is an area that you really need to work on, and yes, it's one of those bits of self-awareness that I certainly try to encourage in my learners, and hopefully in myself as well, that it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter how long you've been doing this job, you know, there's still lots to learn and things mm-hmm. to get right. But yeah, in terms of knowing what's good and what's not good, I mean, I would say that I think there's definitely something about looking for some sort of evidence base to it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, where's it coming from? What's the evidence for the claims that are being made? Where's the data? Where's the research that supports that? I'm not saying that everything that we say we have to have a quote underneath it from a piece of academic research, but I do worry about all of the sort of off the top of head advice that you get on something like YouTube, mm-hmm. Which, you know, okay, everybody's got a right to their opinion. Absolutely, I support that. But it doesn't mean that it's a good idea to follow it. And so that's the tricky bit, I think.
Certainly it is. And, I agree with that as well. I mean, and there's a lot of established research, institutes that are out there that have did studies for decades. Mm. So it's like, start there.
Yeah.
And then you can find things that kind of align with that. But again, we just live in a culture where it's so easy that everybody wants to be affirmed and nobody wants to be offended. That's right. And mm-hmm. nobody wants to be told they're doing a bad job. And, you know, that's just what we've evolved to as a society, unfortunately. But leaders have to kind of rise above that, because leadership is about going above the everybody wants to be right. It's like sometimes you got to push the ship in the other, or lead the ship in the right direction, which is opposite of everybody else's direction. There's some good things. That's what I appreciate. The things you do, you have a lot of sources there and citing that. And I'm learning from that too, that it's important. Cite some resources. And you sure you'll have people that'll say, oh, I don't agree with that. And I'm like, that's okay. But at least you say, well, somebody out there agreed with it. 10,000 people that they asked. Yeah.
Well, that's so right. That's right. Yeah. And you know, some of the, there's good research and there's not so good research. I mean, that is true too. Mm-hmm. So it's not like, as long as it's got a paper behind it, it means it's good. I think, there are definitely some risks to just accepting everything somebody says, you know. So the question is, okay, well, let's have some evidence. That doesn't mean that there's still not disagreements, you know. There absolutely are, and there's always exceptions to rules, and all of that, which is what makes the social world so interesting. And actually, leadership and management is social science. You know, that is basically where it sits. And
that's right.
So we're still trying to work all that out. You know,
yeah, it's an ongoing, evolving thing. It's changing every day.
All right, so let's kind of summarize. I can't help it, I'm still a trainer at heart. So let's summarize.
Summarize. Okay, bullet points out, Stephen.
Yeah. So for me, I think we've said, you know, it is a natural thing. It happens in every industry. People get promoted to positions without really having the training and the skills necessarily to do it. They might have the potential, but they don't necessarily have the skills currently. And I think we said that giving people a bit of a taster and gradually easing them in. So first of all, identifying talent, identify potential, and then gradually ease them into that over time is one of those things. And then taking advantage of all the different things that there are available, like, you know, online books like yours, and then you've got in-house training, and then you've got the external sorts of programs right up to, you know, MBAs and masters and so on. which have their place as well. So, you know, you can keep doing this for a whole lifetime, really.
That's true. Absolutely, 100%. And at the end of the day, I mean, if we want to be able to find good leadership, then we have to set the example as leaders.
Yeah.
And that's where that really is where it starts, because they say the one of the true marks of a good leader is that they promote leadership to the point where other people want to be that.
Yeah.
And it starts with finding the right leadership building materials. So out there, don't you know, just promote based on the widget quota that they're surpassing.
and I will say, I suppose from a final word of mine, you can say more if you want to, Jared. My own final word is that I guess I'm towards the autumn of my career now. So I've probably got another 10 years of nose to the grindstone left in my career, although I can't see me retiring properly. But I am excited and really impressed often by the young managers that I meet and the people that are about to sort of step up to management roles. I love to see them and their intelligence and their enthusiasm and the fact that they care about what they're doing. So I'm actually quite optimistic about managers of the future. So that's a good sign. I think we've got good talent coming up.
Yeah, I'll toast to that. That's definitely something that I have seen as well. And they're bringing balance to the universe of leadership, because
absolutely,
the old school leadership style of, you know, suits and ties and briefcases and pounding the boardroom table, that just isn't how we roll anymore. So
absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely right. Good. I enjoyed that conversation.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Loved it.
Jared, and thank you everybody for watching or listening, whatever forum you're doing that. And don't forget, please subscribe to this podcast or this YouTube channel, whichever you're listening on. And tell somebody else about this channel. If you think there's something useful here, you could call it free training if you like. And join us and tell other people about it. Just send them a text and give them a link. And the more people we can get in this little club, the better, I think.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Bye.
See you.